We'll go and greet the Papa. We don't expect Papa to get up to come and introduce himself to us. The Asian Mariners will not and should not stand up. We will go and meet them. If you want to live long, you must go and meet them. Yes. See why? Meet, move, let them know you. Let them know you. We have people joining us from outside the country via Zoom, from UK, from the United States, Canada, parts of North America. Me too, you can come and check me on. Yeah, that is spirit. And of course, we must check our special guest of honor. Ancient Mariner from the wonderful class of 1952. DJ, you can give us some cool music, very cool and quiet one. Very cool and quiet. Let's come and shake me too now. Thank you very much. As we go back to our seats, thank you very much. Thank you very much. Thank you so very much. We want to start formally now. Thank you. Thank you very much. All right, we want to formally start now. On behalf of the class of Friends, Government College Igeli, we formally welcome all of us here to this meet and greet in honor of one of our ancient mariners from the wonderful class of 1952. Our ancient mariner, James Ifikodo. We'll be doing the real introduction later, but that's why we're here gathered. And so please, we'd like to say welcome, and we are going to have a beautiful evening. The next 2-3 hours, we're going to have a beautiful evening. And this is what the class of Friends have decided to do. Once a while, pick up one of our Asian mariners that have done so well that we can copy from, we can emulate from, we can tap one or two things and honor them. We've done that with one of our prof that has passed on. And during the challenges when he was passing on, he said that it was one of the most exciting events and activities he had. We know we're all getting here, we all have children. We know that come one day, we'll dance behind the box. But that's not, it's when you are alive, you should be celebrated. That's it, we need to change the narrative. It's not when you're dead, you do all the plenty big things, because the man you're doing it for doesn't know, he doesn't see, he doesn't hear. Celebrate the living. Celebrate the living. So this is an evening with Ancient Mariner James Ifikodo. Can we please put our hands together for ourselves? We are going to do the real introduction later, but we just want to roll with the ceremonies. We want to start with an opening prayer. Okay, and Pastor Bates Oyeke, the president of class of 79, is going to lead us in the opening prayers. Yes, you can know a pastor, you know them. Amagada, you see your people. Sweet P. speaking. Please can we all rise up to our feet, gentlemen. If your religion permits, you need to take off your hats. Please come up stage. Come up stage. All right.
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for today. We thank you because at the beginning, you were there. You helped us in conceiving this program. You guided us in planning it. And today, we commit all our activities unto your holy hands. As we celebrate one of our own today, the Lord, you guide us, you lead us in all that we do today, so that at the end of the day we have a cause to glorify your holy name. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen.
Thank you very much, sir. Can we give him a warm round of applause, please? Because when your prayer, God spoke to me. When you were praying, God ministered to me that there will be refreshment when we eat. He also spoke to me that there will be drinks when we will drink. You people don't believe that prophecy. Why are you laughing? It's a wonderful prophecy that somebody should shout and receive it. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we are going to have fun. That's why we're here gathered. We want to have fun. Life itself is short. Life has challenges. If you want to go with the challenges, I don't think you'll live it. So please, we try to tell people, take it as easy as you can. When there's an opportunity to laugh. There's an opportunity to eat. You can tell the next 2 minutes. So we are taking the national anthem and of course the school anthem in a row. We have this set of gentlemen that will do it for us. Please, can they get another mic? That is already here. National anthem, I think we should rise to our feet, please.
Thank you.
Arise, O compatriots, Nigeria's call obey. To serve our fatherland with love and strength and faith. The labor of our heroes' cause shall never be in vain. To serve with heart and might, one Sur, juvenest dum surbus, hostis undam juvet sutem, multam senectutem, nos labedit humus, nos labedit humus. Ubi sunt qui ante nos, in modo fuere, ubi sunt qui ante nos, in modo fuere, transias ad veneros, transias ad inferos, osi vivere, osi vivere.
I think they deserve more than that. They deserve more than that. They deserve more than that. As they were singing, I was asking myself, is this our school anthem? Is this the one Daddy Akboro taught us? It's a different flavor. Yeah, I think. But from the song, you know that we are an elite school. If you look at other school anthems, it's a bit rough, jovial, but this one is so cool, calm, calculated. We were privileged to go through that school. And I look at that school today and I look at some universities and I ask ourselves, what's the difference? We were lucky. Can we give ourselves a warm round of applause?
It's the
CY, please, I need your attention now. What we're trying to do, please CY come. Like I did say earlier on, we know the challenges of doing this event. Challenges will come and definitely they will go. We'd like to introduce nearly every person here. We'll take it a bit by bit from the register that we have. We may not do the proper introduction all the time. We'll try our best. First, I'd like to thank all the people that have been here since the past 3 hours. The ancient mariners that have been here since the past 3 hours. They came on the dot one. Some came 1:30. Please, can we clap for all the ancient mariners that came before us? And this is the example they try to impact on us younger ones. We don't take it. In their time, they tell you, come two. Two is two. Then we had values. We still have values, though. We still have values. We can argue that. But the values are, we don't understand the values again. I just have a list here, and please, if you hear your name, just stand up. We just clap for you. Professor Douglas Omoto, can we give him one round of applause, please? Let's give him one round of applause. Thank you very much. This is just recognition. We'll go to the real introduction, yeah? Let's just see. We have Chief George Oliwe. Can we give him one round of applause? Thank you, sir. Abraham Ugbaja, thank you, class of 1979. Engineer Dr. Okezie Otuomi, thank you very much.
Otuomi is our guest speaker.
He's our guest speaker. He's going to be talking to us as we go along.
A man with many PhDs.
We have Augustine Biname. He's here with his wonderful wife. Can you please give him a warm round of applause? Thank you.
Austin, thank you very much.
We have Corporal Lucky Ibuke. Can we give him a warm round of applause? Yeah, thank you very much. Thank you for coming. We have Festus Unaba, Onibo, you're welcome, sir. Asian Mariner, we will do the honors of really recognizing the Asian Mariners. Siwa will do that for us. Leonard Utsi, can we give him a warm round of applause? Always smiling, always smiling. I like to get close to that table. We have Bayo Sophie, Bayo Sophie. Thank you very much. We have Efetudo Austin. Can we give him a warm round of applause? We have Eric and Mrs. Adobo, Pastor and Pastor Mrs. Adobo. Eric and Mrs. Abagada. Magada, thank you. From the wonderful class of class 77. We call ourselves the first act children. We are a wonderful class. We have Festus Ifedon Esquire. Is the head of practice, Festus Kayami Shambas. Can we give him one round of applause? You're welcome. I feel them. We have Mr. Joanne Egutiri, one of our guests. Can we give him a round of applause? We also have Mr. John Onyeze, one of our guests. Can we give him a warm round of applause? Thank you. We have Nelson Okinashe. Can we give him a warm round of applause? We have Rosemary Okonji. I hope I got the name right. Mrs. Rosemary, you're welcome, madam. Thank you. Mr. Oyak Batters Oyeke, thank you. Our pastor that just prayed for us. We have Mr. Koju Akeje. Can we give him a warm round of applause? Yes.
Salam.
Akim Salami is here with us. Thank you very much. We have Shola. One of our guests, Mr. Shola Labi, from King's College, class of 1965. The way you are talking these years, you are just saying 1965. Do you even know anything then? Okay. We also have Emmanuel Emoguare. Okay, thank you. We still have more lists we're going to recognize. See why? Let's just recognize properly the Asian Mariners now. Okay.
Yeah, we have a guest of honor, Mr. James Efekudo, Government College Ugeli, class of 1950. We call him Daddy James.
And he's a special guest of honor. Daddy, can you stand up? Let us clap for you, please. He's the one we're honoring today. Let's give him a warm round of applause. You can stand up if you want to. Please. He's the reason for the meet and greet. And today is your day. We are going to learn one or two things. We are going to tap from that intelligence you have. Thank you very much. Please, can we all sit down? Thank you.
Yeah, Daddy James is a foremost educationist from King's College, Ikotokpene. He's everywhere. Ministry, Federal Ministry of Education, you name it. He's going to talk to us today. I guess we'll enjoy that. And another ancient mariner, Mr. Festus Enigwe. Class of. What class? Mr. Enigwe, you are welcome, sir. And we have another mariner, the person of Mr. Uli. Otiwe, thank you very much. Class of 1956.
Can I bring the mic down? Please, let me just bring the mic down, okay?
Yeah, Mr. George Uliwe, aye. Class of 1956.
Is this the way we are clapping for 1956?
1956. When we say someone is an ancient mariner, it means before you become an ancient mariner, you must have left government college 55 years before you become an ancient mariner. So the youngest you could be 55 plus 11, that's 66. But you know, most of these guys, they didn't go to school at 11. I know of some people that went to school at 20. My friend's father, Mr. Brigway, told me he was 20 years in Form 1. And it's now 93 years. It's not here today. Class of 1948. So we got these people, a lot of them, and we really, really, I don't want to say, we admire ancient mariners a lot. In government college, we don't play with any guy called anybody that's an ancient mariner. There's a young one I'm looking for here, but it's not here now. I don't know. Mr. Andrew Rivery said he's in traffic. I think he's the youngest ancient mariner, class of 1964. But he's still very young. He became 70 this month. Mr. Owe, whenever you come, we introduce you and recognize you. I think that's all we have for ancient mariners. Then we'd like to recognize Mr. Sonny from King's College. Simi, yeah.
A round of applause.
He was in Form 1, 1965. And Daddy James taught him biology, 1968. So Mr. Fukobo taught him biology in 1968. Welcome, sir. King's College.
Long life will be my portion.
Then we start recognizing the young people. My classmate, Professor Douglas Omoto. Douglas Omoto was the most intelligent guy in my class. Professor of Economics, a lot of degrees, Oxford University, wherever you name it. I was a lecturer in Delta State University, but I think he now works for consultant to central banks. West African Central Bank, what will you call it? Mr. Omoto, you're welcome. And Omoto will give us the welcome speech today anyway. So we welcome you before you come and welcome us. Then we have Mr. Dudu Akpoto. Mr. Dudu Akpoto was in my class of 1982 A-levels. He's known for philanthropy these days. A very generous man. This time, Mr. Akpoto, you're welcome. And I recognize my house prophet, Mr. Robert Uriyawo, former Kedu's house prophet, a Lagos businessman. Thank you, sir. House prophet, never touched anybody. I want to recognize the young man here. Stand up. Class of 1985. PhD in mechanical engineering, right? Masters, MBA, Masters in what again? Tell me. There are so many. He's going to give us the keynote address. I want to try and see what the young people can offer. You're welcome, Mr. Doctor, Engineer Doctor Otome. Yeah, mechanical engineer is at NNPC at present. Come all the way from Abuja. Welcome, sir.
And we want to recognize the person of Mr. a very young man, class of 2015. He was head of school 2015. So he's from class of 2010. A very nice guy, Mr. Jude Alele, former head of school, GCA. Thank you for coming. We will give us the vote of thanks at the end of the day, all right? Studying engineering in Delta State University as province. You graduate next year. Congratulations in advance. And I want to recognize my wife, Engineer Mrs. Elo Ogude.
You are the killer behind this man, huh? We need to look at you. We need to look at you. You're a strong woman.
You are obviously a very beautiful woman reading engineering and still going to kitchen to cook for CY every day. Thanks, madam.
All right, thank you very much. We still have some names. As they come in, we just recognize them. See what is one in your eyes.
Can I get you? I recognize the head of house in Warrior House, Mr. Masoja. I can't see him here now. Welcome.
Richard Masoja, you're welcome.
And then.
Thank you very much. Mr. Tony Saiki from Linkage Assurance, one of our sponsors always. You're welcome, sir. And my manager, Mr. Collins, thank you very much for being here. Yeah. Thank you. All right, ladies and gentlemen, all people concerned, please, if you don't have your name, we'll try as much as possible to recognize you. But meanwhile, let's put hands together for ourselves. Everybody here is important. Just put hands together for yourself. Everybody here is important. Thank you very much. And we now want to take the opening address. The opening address we'd like to call from the class of HS 1982. Professor Douglas Omoto, to come and give us our welcome address. Can we give him a warm round of applause? Can we give him a warm round of applause? I know this welcome address, we have some financial implications. There must be some financial graph.
I don't know who's paying who now. You actually have charged me about 30 minutes ago to call and give me an open address. Well, it's one of those things. We know that one thing that is very unique about government college in Benin is not just honoring our government. But we know that especially all schools have OPS Association, OPS Associations, those students associations. But as is unique, we want to honor our own, especially the older ones, we call them the ancient mariners. So today we are here to celebrate one of our ancient mariners. And we are not going to give a long speech in terms of welcome, but you are welcome to the celebration of one of our ancient mariners, Chief James Ifekodu. I pronounced it well, right? Ifekodu. But at times when you want to recognize Ifekodu, I mean, it loses its meaning. Ifekodu. So I'm very sure I got it right. Now, we got the class of friends since 2017. We'll be celebrating our own. Initially, we'll say it was informal. But right now, the class of friends is now registered with the CAC. It is not competing with the Open Association. Rather, it is actually the kingdom that is expanding. Is that not true, Francis? Yeah, Francis will agree with me that it's the kingdom that is expanding. We're actually trying to complement the efforts of the Open Association. Finally, trying to assist in putting into action some of the things they will have done, but probably for one reason or the other, they'll be able to give the activities they have to cover worldwide. But we're also taking some of the actions from a unique perspective. Few blessings just coming together to say every year we should be celebrating our people. We should be celebrating our old boys who have actually accomplished, who have become beacon of hope, light to others. And so today is not another day. But we have also chosen one, as we also remember that last year we celebrated Professor Isetani. And by God's grace, I think I gave the talk. Oyo. And today, Engineer Doctor Ekobi, joining us to give us a talk today. You are welcome. And I'm sure you are joining the class of friends as well. But this is how we brought you to it. Was prepared to work for the good of humanity, automatically you are a member. And so, for this very year, we are going to celebrate an educationist. His experience is something we can already, try to ink will take a long time. But we also know that he has built people, he has created children in education. Some of them are even retired now, even if he's a retiree. Some have also trained others who have also retired. And so if you say we are celebrating an ancient marine, I will know where we are coming from. Some of the people who have been in government college over 69, 70 years ago, obviously, is to tell the truth is an ancient marine. So, ladies and gentlemen, you are welcome to join the class of friends to celebrate ancient mariner James Efikoto. We are here to wine, we are here to dine. You have enough for everybody. Thank you, and you are welcome. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Prof. That was a very wonderful one. Can we give him a warm round of applause? Please, let's make it a bit lively. Can we give him a warm round of applause? Thank you very much. As we go ahead, once people come in, we recognize their presence. I was talking with Daniel Fekudo, and he said something very important. He said, Nigeria is producing unemployable graduates. And I asked him, what does it mean? He said, he's going to tell me later. That this country, by the day, is producing unemployable graduates. So where did we get it wrong? How did we get it wrong? For those of us that graduated and have jobs, are we the lucky few? So he's going to tell us. That's why we're here, to tap into some of the good things he has already done. But meanwhile, I want to make it easy now. I want to make it a bit lighter. We have some entertainment, and we want to start with a dance. Please, as they come in, let's give them a warm round of applause. Are we ready? Can we give them a warm round of applause? The belly dance, belly dancers. We can do better, we can do better, we can do better. It is not a small thing. For those of us watching via Zoom, we'd like to say we greet all of you. Yeah.
for rushing it from my back.
Can we give them another one round of applause? We have another entertainment before we go to our keynote speaker's lecture.
They are the flexibility, the controls, body bender. Thank you.
Stop it! Stop it! Stop it! Calm down!
Baby, right. I know when we started out, it was things you didn't know. But baby girl, we got a lot of things we need to discuss. I know I'm asking for a lot, but just trust.
All right.
You say the things getting old, sneaking around, creeping in love on the low.
Mr. DJ, this time I'm coming to you. Once a while, play High Life. Our fathers don't even know the music you're playing. Let them feel part of this thing. If you have Victor Waifu, Olaya, David Olaya, once a while, just chip it in. Which one is all this rapping, rapping? They don't, Daddy, do you know Bobby Brown? Mommy, am I saying something? Please, so please, once a while, just chip it in. All right, the prof said something about the class of friends and the GCU Old Boys Association. We all know the challenges we are having. We're not new to it. The class of friends is to complement. It's not competing. We're not competing. We've all gone to the school. We're all out of the school. We're not competing. Please. And we need to tell ourselves the truth. We have to put an end to this thing. All of us, as members of the school, it's not anybody's responsibility. It is our responsibility. We must put an end to it. And we call on the Asian Mariners to help us. Your advice, your fatherly advice will go a very long way. All right, we want to call our keynote speaker. Our keynote speaker, Engineer Dr. Orezi Kenneth Otomi. I have his bio here. He has BSc Mechanical Engineering, MSc Mechanical Engineering, Thermofield Option, MSc Engineering Management, MBA Operation Research Option, Masters in Energy and Petroleum Economics, PhD, Head and Mass Transfer Engineering. He's a fellow of the Nigerian Society of Engineers. He's a fellow, the Nigerian Institute of Mechanical Engineers. He's also a fellow, the Chartered Institute of Public Management of Nigeria. He's a certified project manager. He's a professional of the United States Project Management Institute. I thought we can be clapping for this man. And he's a young man. He's a young man. These are the role models we want. Ladies and gentlemen, without wasting time, let's listen to what Engineer Dr. Orezi Kenneth Otomi has to tell us. Can we give him a one round of applause? Do you want to use the stage or you want to use there? You want to use there? Yeah. All right. Thank you. Come to the stage. Come to the stage. Head of house, I said, come to the stage. Thank you. Can we give him a one round of applause? A warm round of applause, a warm round of applause. Just come, yeah. Engineer Dr. Orezi Kenneth Otomi. You're welcome, sir.
The name is Okezi Kenneth Otomi. Okezi is an Isoko name. I want to start with my protocols. My agent, Marina, Chief James, Aboro Ifokodo, other ancient mariners here present, my seniors, my distinguished professor, Omoto, the head of houses here present, my classmates, distinguished ladies, and gentlemen, good afternoon. It's a rare privilege and honor to be called upon to deliver a lecture at such a time as this. When I was called about a week ago, I spoke with my friend engineer, Dr. Samuel Ajugbe. I said, what is the topic? He said, no, I have to choose the topic of my choice. I told him, I said, well, I'm not going to speak anything on engineering because the audience is a wide one. If I'm going to talk on engineering, it will look too different. Some people may not have that bias. So I'm going to speak on leadership that appeals to everyone here in Nigeria. And I choose the topic, Leadership Conundrum, the Nigeria Paradox. I will start with a preamble. The preamble is like a story. There was a certain man that worked and lived in Abuja for 18 years. He ran his own company from 2001 to 2014. Thereafter, he relocated to Australia. From his experience, in the 14 years that he ran his own company, everything seemed wrong with Nigeria. The director won't give you contract except you pay upfront. The banks won't give you loan except you concede a certain percentage. The man supervising the contract would pass the job except you play ball. The clerk would pass your file for payment except you grease his palm. The accounts department would raise your payment voucher or check unless you see them. Your company name will not be included in the bid list unless you know somebody that knows somebody. The worst thing is that it has become a norm that nobody sees anything wrong with it. If you think otherwise, they begin to think you are sick and either subnormal or abnormal. If you try to stand in their way, you get killed because you put your life at risk. And if you get killed, there is no justice system in place to seek redress and bring the perpetrators to book. The best statement you will hear is this: the government totally condemns this dastardly act and will do everything to bring the perpetrators to book. But they are never brought to book. The police is corrupt. The judiciary is not better. Even the religious circle has been infiltrated. Everything in Nigeria revolves around corruption. Nobody cares about anybody. There seems to be no law and order until the common man infringes the law. When the common man infringes the law, you will know there is law in Nigeria. I look from my left to my right. Everybody is desperate about one thing. And what is that thing? Money. They will kill anybody and anything that stands between them and money. We have shattered electrical engineers registered with Koren and certified by Nigeria Society of Engineers, business gurus, and own and run effective companies. But the Nigerian system today doesn't care about your qualifications and competence. Distribution and transmission jobs are given to allergies, pastors, friends, relatives, and cronies without any basic skill. Consequently, contracts are subcontracted to others at ridiculous offers, and the obvious consequence is project abandonment and outrageous contract variation. People are beginning to ask themselves, how do we convince our kids that education and hard work pays in this country? It seems to me that everybody thinks only about what benefits him. Nobody thinks about the well-being of the state called Nigeria. What then is the problem? This trend has to stop. It all rises and falls on leadership. To portray this point, I'm going to give two examples of leadership. Joseph Stanley was ruled the defunct Union of Soviet Socialist Republic. He was a brutal dictator with a mind of his own. On one fateful day, Stanley came to Politburo, meeting with a life-seeking. Standing in front of his audience, he started to pluck off the feathers of the live chicken one by one. The chicken trembled in pain, blood trickling out of his paws. It gave out grievous cries. But Stanley, being a cruel detector that he is, continued without remorse, plucking the feathers out until the chicken was completely naked. After which, he threw the chicken on the ground. The naked chicken was staggering in pain. Stanley goes to his pocket, and from his pockets, he took out some chicken food and started to throw it at the poor and helpless creation. The poor chicken in pain started eating, and Stanley started walking towards his seat. As he walked away, he kept dropping some feces on the floor, and the chicken followed him and sat feeding from his feet. Joseph Stanley then turned to members of his political party leadership. He said, "This chicken represents the people." That's the kind of leadership we have. You must disempower them, brutalize them, beat them up, stab them, and leave them. If you do this, go into your pocket and give them peanuts when they are in the hapless and desperate situation. They will blindly follow you for the rest of their life, worshiping you. They will think you are a hero forever. They will forget that you are responsible for their sorrowful situation in the first place. A lot of the people we sing their praises as heroes and our leaders are actually our Joseph Stanley. That's the Nigeria we are today. They are the same people who are responsible for our predicaments, yet we clap for them. We run after them. We are their bodyguards. Now let's look at another leader, a certain King Jimmy Seyowanchong of Bhutan. Bhutan is a very small country located between India and China. This king made history. He's a monarchical leader, mind you. That is, as a king, he has a kind of autocratic powers and absolute power. But look at what he did. He instituted a national assembly. He realized people needed to be involved more in their own government. While many protests are happening in other countries, millions of people fighting for democracies, hating their government in one country, it is the other way around in this country called Bhutan. This country is the happiest country in the world. Basic education and healthcare are free for all. Imagine that in Nigeria, that basic education and healthcare are free. What will it look like? It has the lowest crime rates in the world. And almost no homeless people. We are about 200 million Nigerians, and about 30 million or more are homeless, and you expect to be secure in your homes. That looks ridiculous. King James made Bhutan a unique monarchical democratic system. You know something? He made gross national happiness. You heard me right. Gross national happiness, not gross national product or gross domestic product, a priority of the government. He said any government that cannot provide happiness to its people is not fit to exist. That government should cease. Like I said, it all rises and falls on leadership. Let's look at our country, Nigeria. What is our government priority or priorities? It's very easy for us to say that with our mouth. Sometimes around 2015, a man was campaigning and he said, "I will defeat Boko Haram in less than 3 months. I will," in short, so many promises. Let me not mention them. You know them. But I will ask you, what are our government priorities? How have we fared as a people and as a nation in this regard? This brings us to our topic of this course, Leadership Conundrum, the Nigeria Paradox. A lot of treatises, papers, have been written on leadership by so many experts, and over 120,000 1,000 definitions have been put forward by experts in leadership. And all those definitions are correct in their own context. Depending on the perspective you are looking at leadership, the definition is correct. Thus, if I put forward the definition of leadership here, it's not going to be strange to anybody. So in my own terms, I would define leadership as the function of influencing and aligning people to achieve a common goal in order to sustain a larger entity. That's the idea. That is my definition of leadership. This definition presupposes that every society, group, or organization must have a leader who will provide the direction for others to follow. Otherwise, anarchy or group fragmentation is inevitable. On the other hand, a group or society can have a leader, and the leader in himself becomes a source of anarchy or schism. This is the case that does not understand the essence of leadership. Nigeria as a country is blessed with so much human and natural resources that even the late Nelson Mandela once avowed that the world will come to respect Africa when Nigeria truly rises up to take its place in Africa in terms of growth, development, and industrialization. What this means is simple. Nigeria will be true giant of Africa when it gets its leadership processes and systems right. It is a common saying in the public domain that Nigeria's greatest challenge is leadership. A truly patriotic leadership, devoid of ethnic bigotry, but rather driven by true citizen agenda. When I say citizen agenda, you may have your concept, but I will agree with the concept of the Greeks that define three kinds of people in the society: the idiots, the tribesmen, and the citizen. The idiots are those people that even in exam, they will cheat. While they are in government, they will steal. When they eat banana, they will take the piece and throw them anywhere. The Greeks call them idiots. Then you have the tribesmen. The tribesmen are those people that everything that they do, as far as they are concerned, is determined and defined by their tribe. Tribe here is not just ethnicity. You also see religion as tribe. Then the citizen is that person that will not cheat in exam. Even when he's in government, he will not steal. He seeks for that which benefits the people. He thinks of a universal thing, not citing a project because it's politically expedient. No. Nigeria, as a country, like I said, is blessed with a lot of leaders. But these kind of leaders are terrible leaders that we have today. Between 1950 and 1959, the agitation for an independent Nigeria reached a crescendo with the likes of late Chief Anthony Nahoro, late Chief Obafemi Awolowo, late Dr. Nnamdi Azikiwe, championing the cause of our independence. A common strand among these three persons that I've just mentioned is that they know themselves. They know their limitations. In other words, they understand the first principle of leadership. The ability to lead yourself or lead self is the first step in leadership. So this set of persons that I just mentioned, they had that ability. And so they and Nigeria at that point got it right. It was a step in the right direction. Accordingly, they were supposed to go to the next step of leadership, which is leading others. Awolowo demonstrated his capacity to lead others by forming the action group, as at that time. Azikiwe also demonstrated his capacity to lead others by forming the NCNC. They were successful at leading others. Thus, they qualified to progress to leading Nigeria as a nation. At the level of leading Nigeria, they were expected to provide a unifying transformational leadership that will ensure even growth and development. Awolowo was well posed with his democratic socialism ideology, while Azikiwe was well posed with his new welfareism ideology. But alas, there was a discordant tune, and they missed it at the most critical stage. The result was military jingoism that has bedeviled the nation to date. Time will fail me if I have to chronicle the many coups from 1967 to 1993. The Nigerian landscape has never remained the same since then. In the struggle for ethnic nationality domination, the coups and counter-coups experience never produced the desired leadership, even though they came with so many promises. In our peregrination for a patriotic transformational leader, we have only moved from bad to worse and from worse to worse. Our constitution has aided and abetted this leadership model. How else can we explain it? That in a country of over 200 million people, blessed with over 30,000 professors, over 150,000 PhD holders, an accountable number of master's degree holders in various fields, the Constitution defines school certificate qualification as the minimum requirement to contest for the highest and most exalted office in the Federal Republic of Nigeria. Is that not strange? Great Mariners, in the principle of leadership, setting objective criteria or properly defining the goal or vision is the first step. It is clear understanding of ability to lead self. If you cannot lead yourself, you cannot lead others. I'll be sounding like a record if I have to recall all the incidences of forged certificate scandals among our leaders, even in the so-called hallowed chambers, just to boost their public image and public standing. Toronto certificate comes to mind, with the leader who is supposed to lead himself first before leading others and then leading Nigeria, wrapped in forgery and perjury. I wonder the kind of leadership he will offer. There is a private defeat, therefore public victory is not possible. A good and effective leader must first gain private victory before public victory. Gentlemen of our great college, we are treading on a precipice and urgently need a foundational correction to put us back on the right course. To buttress my point, I will refer to Chapter 2 of the 1999 Constitution of the Federal Republic of Nigeria, which clearly states the rights of the citizen and the role of government in guaranteeing same. This is stated here under Section 13 of that Chapter 2. It shall be the duty and responsibility of organs of government and of all authorities and persons exercising legislative, executive, or judiciary powers to conform to, observe, and apply the provisions of the chapter. 14. Nigeria shall be a state based on the principle of democracy and social justice. Sovereignty belongs to the people of Nigeria, from whom government through this constitution derives all its powers and authority. The security and welfare of the people shall be the primary purpose of government, and the participation by the people in their government shall be ensured in accordance with the provisions of the constitution. 16, the state shall harness the resources of the nation and promote national prosperity, control the national economy in such manner as to secure the maximum welfare, freedom, and happiness of every citizen on the basis of social justice and equality of status and opportunity. Direct its policies towards the promotion of a planned and balanced economic development, that the material resources of the nation are harnessed and distributed as best as possible to serve the common good, that the economic system is not operated in such a manner as to permit the concentration of wealth or the means of production and exchange in the hands of individuals or of a group, that suitable and adequate shelter, suitable and adequate food, reasonable national minimum living wage, old age care and pension, and unemployment, sick benefits, and welfare of the disabled are provided for all citizens. Ladies and gentlemen, this is a very well-crafted constitution, a brilliant one. But now let's look at part two of that same constitution, miscellaneous provision, section 308. Look at what section 308 says. Notwithstanding anything to the contrary in the constitution, But subject to subsection 2 of this section, no civil or criminal proceedings shall be instituted or continued against a person whom this section applies during his period of office. A person to whom this section applies shall not be arrested or imprisoned during that period in pursuance of the process of any court or otherwise. And no process of any court requiring or compelling the appearance of a person to whom this section applies shall be applied for or issued. You crafted a very good constitution in chapter 2. You come to Miscellaneous Part 2, section 308. You are not saying that even if the person frittered away all the monies, he did not do any project, even a promise to do those projects, you cannot arrest him or try him. Have you not nullified what you said in chapter 2? That's the constitution we have. Gentlemen and ladies, does this section not tactically nullify the effect of chapter 2? In my opinion, civil immunity for sensitive political offices is necessary to ensure that political office holders are not burdened with legal matters above their responsibility to the society. However, imposing criminal immunity is anti-democratic and anti-people. It is my opinion that people who are found wanting to face the law, deferring punishment for executive errant infraction is a recipe for abuse of office. Without consequences of betrayal of public trust, practicing law will definitely apply. In this case, people will naturally enrich themselves with the common patrimony they are elected or appointed to superintend if they know that they can escape the law. Looking at section 308 against chapter 2 of the Constitution, there is nothing more to say about paradox of constitution. The constitution in itself contradicts itself. I make bold to say that it is because of this constitutional provision that many political office holders have the brazen audacity to divert public funds into private accounts at will and even bury monies in underground facilities and farmlands. It is my honest opinion that constitutional amendment is urgently needed in this section 308 to set Nigeria free from the claws of visionless and purposeless leaders who parade themselves as politicians, elder statesmen, and technocrats. It is a very disheartening aberration that political office holders turn millionaires and billionaires in space of no time with our commonwealth because we are yet to find true leader who has successfully led himself, led others, and ready to lead Nigeria, and at the same time they are supported by a perverted constitution. Furthermore, if we move our compass to the educational sector, we will wait for Nigeria. There was a time in Nigeria when Nigeria University had the best physics department in the world. There was a time when Indians come to UCH Ibadan for medical treatment. There was a time we had the best physical chemistry laboratory. All these sped onto the path of decline and good old days when a certain leader with warped values and egotistic and unbridled greed and self-centeredness unilaterally cut education budget by 50%. Since then, the Nigerian educational sector has been on unrestrained decline or spiral free fall. Today, Nigerian tertiary institutions are synonymous with strikes and poor funding, where lecturers now market marks for sex. The financially buoyant students buy grades and class of degrees. It's courtesy of the leadership we have had in this country over the years. It is ridiculous that in a country where tertiary institutions are perpetually closed, the political office holders who superintend over these institutions are all over the globe celebrating with their children at their matriculation and education ceremonies in foreign universities, while the ones they superintend over are closed down for their gross incompetence and greed. What a shame our leaders represent and portend to the world. In my opinion, there is need for a constitutional provision to regulate the tertiary education of the children of our political office holders if our universities and polytechnics are to function in normal and optimal mode. Every year, Nigeria spends millions of US dollars to sponsor Nigerians on scholarship to foreign universities. This supposedly scholarship scheme has metamorphosed to steady investment in the educational sector of foreign countries, leaving our own educational sector to wallow in squalor. It is no longer news that when you visit some of our universities, you will find individual lecturers providing electricity for their offices with personal generators. My professor, sir, is it not true? For the unfairness of the salaries of our university dons, I've stumbled on a lecturer smoking cassava flakes in the office just to have something in the stomach that will give him strength to deliver the next lecture. And you tell me there will not be brain drain. You tell me there will not be brain drain. There will be brain drain. This goes to show the premium our leaders place on education. No wonder we are the lowest ebb of technological and industrial growth 50 years after independence. Imagine what the educational sector will look like when there is the right investment and motivation in the sector. For instance, imagine a legislation which compels every oil company in Nigeria to set aside 0.3% of its profits for the funding of our tertiary institution, not for selective scholarship via TED Fund. Because even TED Fund itself is abused. A legislation which compels the oil companies to collaborate with the tertiary institution in the areas of research and development. I tell you, Nigeria educational sector will be an El Dorado. Let's go further down into our economy. In the area I stay in Edo State, I work in Abuja, my family is in Benin. I consume 500 liters of PMS to run my generators and fuel my cars on a monthly basis. From my studies and my analysis, 70% of this consumption is on my generator. With 90% confidence interval, this consumption pattern is the same for every Nigerian and Nigerian business. If we convert all solar inverter systems to equivalent of liters of PMS, ceteris paribus. Now, going by the data given by NNPC, we consume about 50 million liters of PMS daily in this country. This implies that 70% of this consumption is on generators. When 70% is converted based on 50 million, it translates to 35 million liters. That is, 35 million liters out of the 50 million liters of PMS is consumed by generators. We are obviously running a generator-powered economy. No wonder the cost of production is very high and discouraging in Nigeria. And this is passed down to the average Nigerian via high prices of goods and services. Now, suppose we fix the power sector in Nigeria and electricity is available for, say, 22 hours daily. Then consumption will reduce to 2.9 million liters for generators. When we add this value to the balance 15 million liters consumed by vehicles, it will be 17.9 million liters that we need. If our existing refineries work at 90% capacity utilization, with their fleet clocking catalytic unit working at optimum efficiency, we will produce about 18 million liters of PMS daily. This production value will offset the 17.9 million liters required for the vehicles and the minimal generator power supply. And with Dangote Refinery coming on stream shortly, we will be a net exporter of PMS. If this happens, it will go a long way to save foreign exchange for Nigeria, reduce the demand for the dollar, reduce the pressure on the naira, stimulate growth of small businesses, increase GDP contribution of the petroleum as more value is added to the hydrocarbon within the country, and provide employment via external economies of skills as other businesses spring up to life around functional refineries. But alas, what do we have? Leadership that faces power sector in 6 months on paper, making the power sector a conundrum. Were we not told in this country some time ago that power can be fixed in 6 months? And yet we are still suffering epileptic power supply. Ladies and gentlemen, greatest mariners, it is high time we woke up from our deep slumber, from those thin lines that divide us along ethnocentric, fraternal, and tribal sentiments, to choose individuals that can, and we provide the right leadership that will make Nigeria great again. No nation can be great by deliberately choosing mediocrity above excellence. No nation can be great without steady power supply. No nation can be great by deliberately and calculatedly removing leadership opportunities from the reach of those endowed and blessed with the leadership capabilities and performance that we desire. Leadership is made of substance, humanity, and morality. And we are painfully short of all these three qualities in our collective lives with this present trend. I will conclude by saying that another chance is here again. 2023 is around the corner. Let's make a decision to demystify by choosing excellence above mediocrity, by choosing track record of success and performance above any religious, fraternal, and ethnocentric ties, by choosing integrity and honesty above cosmetic promises and godfatherism, by choosing character above brand envelopes, by choosing those people with clear vision and well-articulated and documented blueprint to make Nigeria a next self-sufficient nation again, by choosing those pragmatic people who with all determination and sincerity will make our power sector and sea sector functional again, by choosing those people who will vigorously pursue import substitution and export promotion, by choosing those people who will stand to defend a restructured constitution, no matter whose us is God, by choosing those people who have successfully led themselves, led others, and are ready to lead Nigeria. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you.
Thank you very much. I think it deserves more. Thank you. Coming from an engineering perspective, talking about leadership, I think we took you up to another lane, and of course, you really did it. Can we give him another warm round of applause? I know most of us must have taken one or two.
Okay, you stay here.
And maybe somebody else, we can take one or two questions. One or two, please be here. One or two questions. Do we have one or two questions? Okay.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I will start on existing protocols. One of the quarrels that happened in River State between Amechi and Wike is that during Amechi's time, some Nigerian students from River State were sent to United Kingdom, America, with scholarship, with pounds and dollars, to study business administration. When UK came in, he stopped paying the scholarship. Similarly, during that time too, some Nigerian students in River State, children, were sent to Obasanjo University Secondary School to enjoy air conditioning. Now, my question is this. Is it right for the government of Nigeria, whether state or federal, to send any person to overseas to study business administration? Thank you.
Thank you very much for that question. I will answer this question like this by telling you a story first. One of my professors is late, Professor O.O. Akindele, of University of Lagos. He said when they graduated from school far back in 1972, he and some other persons, some other Nigerians, were sent to Russia to spy technology, to steal technology. Then the Nigerian naira was very strong, more than the US dollars, almost at par with the British pounds. So when they got to Russia, some other countries, Pakistan and different countries, also came. See, but because of the much naira in their pocket, they have so much money, instead of them to focus on what they were asked to do, they will go and carry the Russian girls. Then the Pakistanis, the Indians that came with them, that after the lectures, in the cool of the evening, they will take their cameras and go to the factories of the Russians. They begin to record everything. So they finished. He said, today is telling us, I was in my final year, he was telling us, that their generation has failed Nigeria. That his mates in India and Pakistan, they designed this, they designed that. They measured the things and they manufactured them there. That here in Nigeria, even compressor for a refrigerator, they could not do. To come back to your question, business administration is not a specialty that you will send people abroad to go and study. If you want to study business administration, whatsoever, and you need a high class school, we have Lagos Business School. All the gurus are there. Go and study business administration. But if you tell me you want to send somebody to go and steal nuclear technology, I'm not even saying nuclear engineering, I will agree with you. Because there is difference between the technology and the engineering. And you know there are specialized courses that when you go abroad, like to US, to UK, to France, to Germany, there are specialized courses that they will not allow a foreigner to read. And one of them is nuclear technology. Thank you, sir.
Wow. That's a new one. So there are some courses they won't allow the black man to read. That's share with the CM. So we say, okay, can we take one more before we go? One more. Before we welcome Ancient Marina to come and talk with us. Can we take one more? Okay, can somebody do a small vote of thanks for him? Somebody, can somebody do a small vote of thanks for him? Somebody, please. Okay.
Engineer Dr. Otomi, we are aware that you were called upon at very short notice. And we are proud of what you have done today. We will continue to wish you greater heights in all your endeavors. We pray that the next time we see you is at the presidency, because we need people at those junctions to make a big difference in this country. I wish you well. Thank you very much for all you have done.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. This school is loaded. And thank God we called you at a short notice. Maybe if we had called you at a long notice, it would have been worse than this. All right, I want to make it exciting. Some classmates just came. Some old boys just came in. I think, can we give a warm round of applause to Agumi? You're welcome, sir. Thank you. And I saw Newman Akbore somewhere. Where is he? Newman was with us. Can we give him a warm round of applause? Antonio Kwoju, I see him there. Can we give him a warm round of applause? You're welcome, sir.
Let me use this opportunity to acknowledge the presence of a very good old boy. He was former National Publicity Secretary of GCU OBA, class of 1970. Mr. Cliff Akora, please. Another man for class of 1970, Mr. Well, thank you very much for coming. And the youngest Ancient Marina, Mr. Andrew Oyewere, is here now. Thank you very much. And Engineer Augustine Igbineke. Thank you. He's one of our major sponsors for this event. Thank you very much for your generosity. Yeah, salsa, eh?
So once we get some dance, now the salsa dancers are coming. So the salsa dancers.
It's the voodoo.
Stop it. Stop it. Calm down.
nothing, nothing without a woman or a girl. You see, man made the cars to take us over the road. Man made the train to carry the heavy load. Man made the electrolyte to take us out of the dark. Man made the boat for the water, like Noah made the ark. This is a man's, man's, man's world. But it wouldn't be nothing, nothing, without a woman or a girl. Shake your body, baby, do that conga. No, you can't control yourself any longer. Come on, shake your body, baby, do that conga. No, you can't control yourself any longer.
To welcome our Asian mariner, Daddy James, if a kodo, as you call it, to come and talk to us. Ladies and gentlemen, please, can we give him a standing ovation? Can we stand to our feet as he comes to the stage? Let's be clapping for him. Yes. We can do better, we can do better, we can do better. We can do better. Thank you. Can we sit down? I think we need a better light. We need a better light. Like what we say, the class of friends, we try to do this once a while. We've done it for Professor Clark. Blessed memory. It was a very wonderful evening. And quite recently, last year, we did it for Ishesage San. It was a very wonderful evening. And today, we said we'll do it for Daddy James Efekodo. It's a way of honoring
are ancient mariners. Somebody that went to school in 1952. I don't know how many of us were here in 1952. How many of you were born in 1952? Let me give you five. High five. 1952. All right. We are ready now, Daddy. Migosa.
Okay. I hope you can hear me. I prefer to be heard. That is every single word I'm about to say, I think will add up eventually. So I want to hear every word. I began by saying, and I've written it down here, so I'm going to read it first and hope that you'll use what I'm telling you to ask your questions. Does that make sense? I said, ladies and gentlemen, I see many of you from the 1977 class of GCU as my younger brothers. I hope none of you here will attempt to contest this. Having said this, I know I'm talking to friends and brothers. To save time, I intend to give a summary version of this talk now so that we can continue the chat and arguments later within the group. I promise to discuss these issues further. I'm already in your platform, and so when I say I promise, by the grace of God, I will keep answering questions on what I'm talking about right now, later on. Although you can ask questions today. The purpose of our lives on earth, as I've always maintained, is to know, love, and serve God so that we can be happy with Him here and later in eternity. You cannot love whom you do not know. Serving an unknown person is very difficult. God knows in advance that we need freedom in order to love anyone. Now I'll tell you the topic proper. Maybe I did not tell you the topic at the beginning. You can now see the word freedom has now surfaced. The topic is the goal of education is freedom. The goal of education is freedom. You can now see how I hope to develop my arguments in order to arrive at this conclusion that the goal of education is freedom. So God gave us freedom from the very beginning and took a risk, because if you misuse it, you may end up loving God's enemy. You know God's enemy? Yes, so God gave us freedom and said, well, go ahead. I hope you'll come back to me at the end of your lives. That is the risk. I'm going to tell you that I have taken what you may call a bit of a tricky thing to say, that freedom is one word and free will is another set of words, but basically both freedom and free will mean the same thing on the long run, okay? But what is freedom? I shall explain it later. Education, as I had also explained previously, may be seen as either leading someone from ignorance to knowledge, or, as an expert says, education is an introduction to total reality. An introduction to total reality. Reality is found along the way, that is, at every rung of the ladder, or at the end, which is the destination of the search. You will find reality at the end. But along the way, as you are climbing up the ladder, there's also reality. So total reality is what you will find at the end of the journey during your search. With these simple explanations, I believe we can now continue with the other aspects of what I think we should take seriously as we live our lives. Faith and reason, religion and science. I must now admit that along the way, I've always wondered why there should ever be any conflict between faith in God and reason, which for the purpose of this talk can be equated with all forms of philosophical thought, including facts deduced from scientific observations that have been confirmed experimentally. So you have this issue of what's it called? Faith. It's not a blind leap. People just assume that, well, those who have faith are taking it for granted. No. A lot of reasoning is also within that faith. You don't have faith in something in which you have not thought out. You don't believe in it. Then you cannot say you have faith. But when you think about it deeply, you say, yes, I believe in it. Even though you cannot prove it. That's the point about faith. You cannot prove it, but you have faith. Some will even tell you that sometimes faith comes to you almost like in a dream. Suddenly it comes. I've heard it said, and to some extent I also believe it, that faith is infused into your soul, for those who are Christians, and I hope some of you are Christians here, at the time of baptism. If you remember the discussion between Nicodemus and Jesus Christ, I think it's John chapter 3. Nicodemus came to see Jesus Christ in the night. He was a Pharisee, a very learned person in his own right, and he came secretly because he was afraid of his contemporaries, the other Pharisees, who were always challenging Jesus Christ. So he came secretly, and Jesus Christ told him, I said, unless you are born again, remember that story? Unless you are born again, you cannot come to the kingdom of heaven. You cannot see God. And he said, a grown-up man to be born again, what does that mean? And said, do I have to go back to my mother's womb? Jesus Christ said, no. To be born again means to be born of water and the Spirit. That is how God, how Jesus Christ explained it to Nicodemus. It may surprise some here to know that 2,500 years before Christ, that is even before Jesus Christ, whom Christians believe is God, some ancient Greek philosophers, led by Socrates, had postulated and found the existence of a spiritual soul in all human beings. So spiritual soul did not just come with Christianity. That mere use of reason had led Socrates 2,500 years before Christ to say the human being must have a spiritual soul by thinking about it. and what a human being can do, they came to that conclusion, which of course we now know is true. By the sheer use of reason alone, they believe that man must have not just a soul, that is the living force that controls all living things, including plants and animals, but a very specialized type of soul, far superior to all other types, because it is always created freshly by God for every human embryo at the time of fertilization. This spiritual soul is responsible for why human beings are different from all other living things. I used to teach a subject known as philosophical anthropology to SS2 and SS3 students. We had to create that subject. The human being is unique. And the first question I usually ask them, go and search what it means when I say the human being is unique. As a biologist, some of us, we read a lot about Darwin and other things. I shall mention Darwin later on. But the human being is not just an ape like all the other great apes. Dr. Lobinger is here. He's a medical doctor. Some of you are medical doctors. If you dissect the human being, it appears to have the same organs with all other apes. The head, the lungs, everything. Of course, you will not expect to see the soul. It's a spirit, so you cannot see it. I heard somebody at University of Lagos once said, a zoology lecturer once said, you Christians, you believe in soul. I've been dissecting frogs and dissecting rabbits for many years. I have never seen a soul. That's a whole senior lecturer at University of Lagos. Nobody ever told that it is something physical. It is spiritual. So that's the soul. But the human being is unique. Even in his physical characteristics, try and dress a gorilla like I'm dressed now. You'll be surprised. It's so difficult. He doesn't have a waist, ordinary waist. You'll be surprised when you see films, cinema, with apes dressed like human beings in suits. It's a very difficult assignment indeed. They don't have a waistline like ours. So the human being is different. The human being is different in so many other small ways, but the most important difference between the human being and all other animals is the spiritual soul. That's the difference. And this spiritual soul is created by God at the time of fertilization of the spermatozoon with the ovum. At that critical time, the soul is delivered to that combination, that's the fertilized soul, ovum, and the human being becomes different. At the time of baptism, they say again, it is this soul, the human soul, into which faith is infused. It is important because I've heard of a professor at University of Oxford University, I don't know what, Hawkins, born 1941, he's three years my junior, who is a confirmed atheist. I ask, was this man ever baptized? I've heard of many people who say, I don't believe in God. I ask, were they baptized? It appears that baptism is very critical into this issue of faith. That you may be lucky to have faith, But some people don't seem to have it at all. So in everything they say, prove it to me. They have to be, you have to argue with them first. Say, yes, I believe in this. But he says, I don't believe. And he's not a professor. That man has been misleading people at Oxford University. Just Google it and find out. And at the last time I read about him, he said, on a scale of 1 to 7, on the scale of 1 to 7, I will say I am around 6.5. He didn't say 7, 6.5, that there's no God. Can you follow such a person? A person who tells you, on a scale of 1 to 7, I think about 6.5, I don't believe there's God. One day he may change again and say, sorry, I now believe there is God. By which I mean it's too late. You get the point? So such people can be very delicate. Dealing with an atheist is very difficult because today he says, I don't believe. Tomorrow, he can change and say, I now believe. I will talk about one or two of them whom I know. Know that Jesus Christ confirmed this throughout his teachings, which we now call the Gospels. At death, it is the special soul that separates from the body. Sorry, the spiritual soul that separates from the body and reports instantaneously for its particular judgment. The soul can be compared to some extent to the hard disk of a modern computer. It stores everything that make up the unique essence and personality of individuals. So when the soul departs from the body at death, it is you, the complete you in many ways. It goes straight for judgment because all what good you did and all what bad you did while you're on earth are also there. So it is valid to judge the soul. It's at the last judgment. Take note, this particular judgment is everyone, one at a time, instantaneous, between you and God, between you and God, between you and God. At the last judgment, at the end, will come together again. This time, each soul will have come back to search for his body. And combined with the body, and then we'll all see ourselves clearly. You will see me, I will see you. And we'll now know those who made it to heaven and those who did not make it to heaven and are now in the other world, where they'll suffer forever. Then you ask me, can I prove this? You ask me that, can I prove this? Is there evidence that what I've just said is the correct truth? All I can say is that as a Christian, I have to listen, and I have to read, and I have to follow the gospel as taught by God himself, because I believe that Jesus Christ is God. And that gives me strength. When I believe that, I begin to argue from there onwards. Saint Augustine, a 5th century saint, wisely said, I believe in order to understand. Think about yourselves. If when you were maybe 2 or 3 years old, somebody said, A, and the child says, what do you mean by A? You're already in trouble. Am I right? He just says A. Before you say B and C, the child says, sorry, what is A? You have a problem, not so? Or 1, 2, 3. Before you continue, you say, stop. What is 1? So you have to believe first before you understand. So that is the method we use in education. You believe that the person talking to you or helping you is taking you somewhere. And later on, maybe when you have gotten your own PhD, you can now begin to question the method. I was asking my son only recently, it takes time to educate. Can you teach mathematics in Urobo language? I happen to be Urobo. We kept on worrying about this matter. Can we teach mathematics in Urobo language? Not easy. Then I said, what is the translation of the figure zero? Z-E-R-O, zero, in Urobo. Some will say, zero is nothing. Is zero really nothing? Are you sure it is nothing? Until zero was discovered as a valuable component, mathematics could not move forward. It could not move forward. Zero is not nothing. Put zero in front of one, it has changed to 10. Put two zeros, it has changed to 100. So zero is not nothing. But when you want to translate it into any Nigerian language, I don't know, you are going to have a problem. So you can educational style, which we borrowed mostly from the United States. Dr. Tai Solarin, may he rest in peace. He was extremely anxious. We cannot continue to use the British educational model forever. We have to do something about it in Nigeria. We all agreed. 1969, we had a curriculum conference in Lagos here and said, let us develop a Nigerian curriculum for a change. We cannot keep on taking Cambridge examinations. Incidentally, my set, 1957, was the very first set in West Africa to take what you now call WAEC. The set before my set, 1956, took Cambridge school certificate throughout West Africa. We were the first to take the one conducted by the West African Examination Council, although moderated by Cambridge University. So I've been trying to take these steps. My set too was among the last sets to take, you may not believe it, English literature. Slowly, it metamorphosed into literature in English. There's a difference. There's a very big difference. We did English literature, and we read books, originals, Charles Dickens, and so on and so forth. I won't go into detail. And they were not easy. Then, there are no Nigerian writers. Chinua Achebe, J.P. Clark, Wole Soyinka were at university. They had reached university as at that time. They had. Things Fall Apart was written in 1958. Chinua Achebe. It was developed at University College Ibadan. And J.P. Clark, Wole Soyinka, they were that set. Before then, there are no novels written by Nigerians, none. Only Cyprian Ekwensi, who passed on, he was a pharmacist. I knew him personally, one-on-one. He went to Government College in Mwahia and began to write short stories, The Leopard's Claw. Very interesting. I don't know how he got it, but they're almost always short stories. So we had no books with which to teach literature. So we learned English literature. Then these books began to come out slowly. Heineken Printing Press at Ibadan and began to say, we can now teach literature in English. You get the point, not so? You understand the point? So that is how it was changed from English literature to literature in English. And at last, we could now read Chinua Achebe and J.P. Clark, which is Ozidi, and Wole Soyinka and other people. And today is now the norm. Although a lot of rubbish has been introduced into the school curriculum, because as a principal, I didn't allow any book to be taught as literature if I had not vetted it, because I had to vet them. One written by Lagos State, I do not know who wrote that. It is called Pure Water. Can you imagine that? I don't know who wrote it. And Lagos State was trying to compel all schools to teach it. I said I will not teach it, because as principal, I had the freedom, even though my degrees are in science, I also taught literature. Because I found that the new sets of graduates had no clue as to how to interpret poetry. So I taught poetry. And I taught JS1, take note, JS1. I didn't say JSS1, because I was there when we discussed these issues. It is junior secondary one and senior secondary one. So JS1 and SS1. You can see the rhyme and reason. You get the point? When you say JSS1, you are talking rubbish. Let us continue. So by 1982, what we began in 1969 had come to fruition, and we're now having the first set of students throughout Nigeria who are going for the very first time for the new type of the secondary education system, which is 3-3. It's not 6, it is 3-3 for a reason which many people have forgotten. It is 3 followed by 3. And then what Shularen was talking about, which we all agreed, why don't we learn Nigerian languages? He says, okay, let us learn Nigerian languages. But we're aiming at one Nigerian language that will eventually compete and replace English. As at 1973, we said, let us start with 3 major Nigerian languages. Today, I tell you this with all seriousness, I feel sad about it. Who teaches Nigerian languages? I don't know. The same WAEC has now made it optional. Whereas it was meant to be compulsory, it was meant to be the core subjects. So how are we going to educate our children? Then I look back, I say, well, were we not being too ambitious? Have you ever seen a physics textbook originating in Yoruba? I have not seen one. Or in Hausa, or in Igbo, I have not seen one. These are the issues involved. That you can teach a language and people will, like a parrot, recite or repeat, but can they think in that language? See what I'm doing now. I'm able to discuss, I hope, with all of you using a language called the English language. It's not my language, not your language, but somehow we are communicating. So we now said, are we really moving towards one language eventually? How are we going to get there? 3 languages we began with 1982 that were compulsory. I cannot now remember any school, any good school, that is teaching Nigerian languages. So simple things like, are we really thinking clearly? If you cannot translate 0 into a Nigerian language meaningfully, if you cannot write a geography textbook in a Nigerian language, or mathematics textbook, or physics textbook, are we not just slowing down the children unnecessarily? So these are issues that are very delicate sometimes, okay? I say this because you may say, how does it connect with what you are telling us right now? We have a problem in Nigeria, and we now know we have a problem. I'm seeing what role some of us can still play in trying to get all of us together again and think clearly. This word freedom, how to end up by saying, are we getting it right? Okay, I just want to say that nobody has seen the soul, but by faith alone and a complete trust in Jesus Christ, we believe in what we have not seen. God can neither deceive nor be deceived. This too is faith in action. Now let us take a brief excursion into science. Look closely at this list. Isaac Newton, gravity. Johannes Kepler, planetary motions. Nicholas Copernicus, heliocentric solar system. Galileo Galilei, astronomy and mathematics. Gregor Mendel, genetics. Pope Gregory the Great, patron of all scientists. Charles Robert Darwin, biologist and the theory of evolution. Albert Einstein, relativity, and so on and so forth. One thing they all have in common was that they were all among the great pillars of modern day science. Another thing is the fact that they were all men of faith. They may have heard of Mr. and Mrs. Curie. Curie is a French name. That's where a woman comes in for the very first time. And surprisingly, this one woman, Marie Curie, is the only person that has won two Nobel Prizes, one in physics and one in chemistry. The only woman in this list. She was a Polish woman, and she discovered radioactivity. She's the only person in this list that has won two Nobel Prizes. It's not easy. It's not an easy feat. But they were all people who believed. They were all people of faith. They were either Jews or Christians. They are not pagans. They are not people who were just, well, atheists. I don't believe in anything. I don't believe in God. They all had a belief. There's a reason why. In all research, whether in the social or experimental natural sciences, you will soon come to the realization that it is faith that pulls reason ever higher to greater heights and makes research attain its objectives. I hear some of you have a PhD, some of you are professors, you are here. Without faith, reason does not rise. And you cannot start any research unless you believe from foundation, from the very beginning of that research, that the answer to what you are looking for can be found. Am I making sense? You cannot start research on any topic unless you believe that at the end of this research, what you set out to investigate can be found. There is an answer waiting for you. So that is also faith. From this explanation, it is curious that some people still have difficulty in accepting that we need both faith and reason to discover the truth. Both faith and reason come from God. So also do science and religion come from God. God can never contradict himself. Remember, this is a summary version of my arguments. If you want me to develop it further, I'll do that. Not right now. So people think that to be a scientist means that you must start by not believing in God at all. Absolute rubbish. There's nothing worse than that. That all scientists do not believe in God. Absolute rubbish. Every great scientist, the ones I've mentioned so far, and the ones I've studied, they all have faith. And they all have a belief. Because when you look around, look at this room. Look at this room. If you came in from this door and you saw this room arranged this way, it would be surprising if you said, these tables and these chairs arranged themselves. Is anybody who will say that? They were arranged by somebody. Am I making sense? They were all arranged by somebody. If you look up to the sky, incidentally, you can see far, far, farther away at night than during the daytime. I was telling some people I practice photography. If you open the lens of a camera and point it at the sky at night and set the camera the correct way, as I used to do, for a 5 minutes exposure, close it for a 1 hour exposure, close it for a 4 hour exposure. I have done this. Close it and look at what you see. Now we have digital cameras. In my time, we used the analog, not digital, okay? And we developed the negative and then printed the photograph. You'd be amazed. A 4 minutes exposure at night will show some stars. You'll see them as dots. A 1 hour exposure at night will show even more stars, because the effect of light on the film is cumulative. Not called cumulative, okay? So it adds on. A 4 hour exposure, you will see even more stars, which you do not see in the 5 minutes exposure. Then you also see the planets as streaks of light, not as, you know, spot like that, okay? You see them as streaks of light because the planets actually move. Relative to the stars, planets move. In fact, that was why the name planet was given to them. Those who were looking at the skies in the olden days used to say, this thing appears to move. It's a planet. The stars are fairly stationary compared with the planets. These are things we're done. Even today, where I live, I look up, I sometimes see some stars or star-like light. Very bright. Actually, they are not stars, they are satellites. They are nearer us, so they are very bright. The ones which are stars, which are further out, are very, very faint. And it requires a lot of time before they can be seen on the film, as the case may be. So that's it. I brought this matter up because if you look that way, you ask, what are those things doing there? What are they doing there? If you now have the opportunity of looking at a good telescope, the first one I saw was at Onsuka, 1965. You will see a cluster of looking like a cloud, dust-like particles. And you are told that is not in this galaxy. Our galaxy is called the Milky Way galaxy. That is Andromeda, under galaxy. Each galaxy, and there are trillions of galaxies, amazing, are there. When I went to Italy, I saw a telescope, and I used the telescope where you can see objects which are 10,000 light years away. Some of you know what a light year is. A light year is a distance light travels in 1 year at the fantastic speed, you know it already, 186,000 miles per second. In 1 year, you can imagine how far it travels. That's a light year. Then you see some stars 10,000 light years away on a telescope. Then you ask, what is all this about? God is talking to all of us. Same as when you enter this room, you saw these chairs and tables arranged. You are bound to ask, who did this? It was done by human beings. Up there, God is talking to us. Who put the sun there? Who put the moon there? Who put the stars? Who put all these things there? Somebody, an intellect, infinitely superior to our intellect, put them there. And they are very orderly. The orderliness alone is what will impress you if you study astronomy. They are not just there, randomly scattered. No. They are there with a pattern, and they are not clashing, they are not fighting each other, because an intellect far, far superior to us put them there. And in, as I see it, it's making you to ask, am I alone on this universe? You are not alone. What am I doing here? That's a good question. You need to ask these questions yourself occasionally. You get the point, not so? And then what are all those things they put there as a teaser? Think now that I give that title to it, Science Has Discovered God at Last. Whereas people used to think that scientists don't believe in God, it is now scientists themselves who are now discovering God. At last, another of my major concerns appears to be resolving itself. You have read the book of Genesis that gives an account of creation. Chapters 1 to 11 had always been known as prehistory. Nobody can say for certain from eyewitness report what really happened on the first days of creation. My HSC students, one of them is here, at King's College in the mid-1960s, whom I taught the history and philosophy of science, not himself, because he was a science student. I taught history and philosophy of science to the arts students. That's how King's College was arranged. They tried to trap me. They knew I was a Catholic, and I'm a practicing Catholic, and they tried to trap me in those days by asking if I truly believed that God created the world in 6 days. My answer then was, if the Bible says so, it is likely to be true. But I did not then have any concrete way of verifying it experimentally in the laboratory. Great strides have been taken by geologists, archaeologists, and anthropologists in the last 50 years since then to verify the biblical creation account. Their combined findings are that, first, the 6 days mentioned in the Genesis account were not of the same duration. Secondly, that from all observations so far, there's a canny accuracy in the sequence of the events. There's no doubt now that light, a blinding light, was the very first to be created, followed almost exactly by all the others, and that man was definitely created last on the sixth day. Princeton University in New Jersey, USA, was probably the first to postulate from experiments in concentrating sound and sound waves that the continuous humming which you hear on top of isolated mountains and hills may in fact be that produced by the Big Bang of creation. I read this from a reputable science magazine, The New Scientist, way back in the early 1970s. So you hear of the Big Bang. It looks like a strange thing that the world began with a Big Bang. It has been proven by scientists to be true. That's a surprising thing, that the Big Bang actually happened and that light was the very first to be created. You know about light and lightning. I hope so. Sorry, lightning and thunder. Light comes first because it travels faster than sound, and sound comes later. They both come together, but light is what you see. That's lightning first before the sound. So the Big Bang is this sound. And that if you climb any hill, try it on top of the hill, and you are alone, you suddenly hear a humming sound. I've heard it from all directions. You ask, what is this sound? Some are now saying definitively it is like the echo, the sound waves from the Big Bang that happened, take it or not, 15 billion years ago, 15 billion that are now reaching us. That is it. So scientists are the ones who are now in the forefront of this research, that in actual fact, yes, something happened, and that the universe was created. And it was created, it had a beginning, and the beginning is about 15 billion years ago. So let me not go, I just want to now tell you very quickly a few other things about some people, especially some top philosophers, amongst which is one man called Anthony Flew, Professor Anthony Flew, an Englishman, fantastic philosopher. He said he was an atheist, but what convinced him to change his view was the fact that if you put a monkey in front of a computer and ask it to type, it will be typing randomly. It will take over one trillion years before it can type, Mary had a little lamb. That's simple thing. Mary had a lip. It cannot do it. It's impossible for a monkey to type it. So that type of thing, you know. The other one is the fact that the structure of the DNA, you heard of the DNA, deoxyribonucleic acid, which we all have and all living things have, when unfolded, and I've seen it, I saw it when I was in London, that is the model of it, it's a fantastic molecule. It is the longest sentence, if you were to turn it into words, that contains 3.5 billion words. That human beings could not have designed that. And that is where the code is like the tool with which God created everything. That is it's like the secret code, the DNA molecule. And that human beings could not have done that. These are the things that convinced some people to at last say, I now give up, that no human being could have done this. Only a super brain, and that is what we call God. Now, I hear, I'm about to round up now. I'll go back to freedom. There are consequences for having this freedom. You cannot do what you like. That is anarchy. You cannot do what you must. That is communism. What the freedom was given to you for is to enable you to do what you ought. What you ought to do at any given time. And it is this freedom that God, in the person of Jesus Christ, died to win back to human beings. That human beings were trapped after what we now call original sin, unable to do good and unable to please God. And therefore, it is worth restoring freedom to the human being. And Christ came to die so that this freedom can be restored to us. Now you know the value of this freedom. It is to be able to do what you could not have done, to do only what you ought to do from now onwards. And what is this all about? I worry about us in Nigeria that we are not taking it seriously enough. We are still attached to superstition. We are too attached to what we call our cultural and traditional values. Some of these things are primitive. There's no doubt about that. They are primitive, and they are not going to move us forward. It is this freedom, if it's well used, that will enable us individually to say, sorry, I've heard you. I don't want to do it that way. I am free to do it the way I think I ought to do it. Don't ever feel that you are trapped. They say, you must do this, then you do it because I don't want to annoy them. Exercise that freedom, and at the end of your life, you will not regret it. I want to end now so that you can ask your questions. It may be a little bit tricky for you to know what I've just said. The topic is, the goal of education is freedom. I've said here, the higher degrees does not mean you are educated. Having all the PhDs in the world does not mean, does not translate to education. That it is, the goal of education is freedom. If you are still feeling that you are not free, you are trapped because of cultural norms and beliefs, you have a problem. That is my case as of now. Thank you very much for listening.
Wow. Can we give him a warm round of applause? Go on, stand up and give him a warm round of applause. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. You can sit down, please. I learned a lot, yeah? I know a lot of us did. Never seen heard where they really dissected the Big Bang Theory. I think I picked something from there. Everybody picked something. Before we go to questions, I just want to recognize one of our big brothers that came in. He's the CEO, he's the owner of Airpeace. He's from this wonderful school, GCU. HSE class of 1982. Allen Oyama, you're welcome, sir. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. He told me that if you want to board the flight today, just talk to me. I will talk to you. We know the way we relate. All right, questions, ladies and gentlemen.
Okay, go ahead.
I know we have questions. Let's take one or two or three from this very robust lecture. We have a hand, yeah? Thank you.
I will stand on the existing protocols. I must say, first of all, before I ask my question, that the lecture was indeed most didactic and very rich. Now, my question goes like this. In the very beginning of this lecture, you may not understand that the being gets a soul at the fertilization of the ovum by the spermatozoa. Yes. And then it is in religion that we believe, especially some sects of religion, that the soul is born with original sin. That is, before the soul gets to this world, it's already with sin. Now, my question goes like this. At what stage does the soul becomes capable of acquiring sin on its own, taking into cognizance of the fact that education indeed will the soul be capable of acquiring sin to itself? You know, for instance, in different crimes, I'm talking about law now, we have the age of which a person becomes liable in certain offense or offenses. Now, lastly,
I will ask. If one is punished for a crime, sinning, quote, for religion, here on earth, for instance, a child of five steals a sweet, and you punish the child, or a man steals a goat, and he goes to prison. Now, having taken that punishment, will he also be still liable in the world to come? In law, we call it double jeopardy. Will he be liable after having served the punishment here? Thank you, sir.
Let me try to answer it. You have done a very good job, okay? All I can say is that, yes, you are quite right. At a certain age, it is difficult to prove that a human being has committed a sin. Although I've heard of 3 months old babies in a baby court. You know the baby court, a court, not so? Twins were lying down side by side, and one, at the age of 3 months, hits the other one repeatedly at 3 months. Was it an accident? I don't know. You get the point? That yes, even as early as 3 months, some evil, I think is a residue, what I call original sin. If those children are not baptized, and that is the only way by which original sin can be wiped off the slate, yes, they can commit small evils. They can commit sin. You get the point? Even at early as 3 months. Although technically, we usually say the age of origin, about age 6 or 7, then you can say, yes, this person is guilty of this particular offense knowingly. He has done it knowingly. That's where the guilt comes from, okay? The guilt comes from the fact that he did it intentionally. He planned to do it, and he executed it. I had a case as a principal where a lawyer told me his son was accused of taking a book from the library and hiding the book and about to go away with the book. The librarian stopped him. And then the case came to my table as principal, reported by the library teacher that this boy tried to steal a book from the library and he was stopped. And we said, it's okay. It is a sign of what he might do later. We suspended him from classes for 1 day. The father, a lawyer, came to me and said, sorry, he didn't agree with me that our judgment was very rash. That there's a difference between taking and stealing. That is what a lawyer told me. You don't want principals to suffer. That there's a difference between taking and stealing. I said, it's okay. Do you want the matter to be taken further? I was ready. I said, I'm not a lawyer. I use the school money to employ a lawyer. And you can argue out in court. Is taking the same as stealing or not? But he relented, not me. He relented first. He didn't want the publicity. He did not want the publicity. You get my point? So I sympathize with your thinking. Yes, there's an age of reason, after which you can say, this boy did this. And until that particular thing is pushed, he may continue along that trend. So we have to handle it now. Have I made some sense? Have I tried to answer your question? It's not easy. As a lawyer, I'm quite right. Yes, not all can be said to say, this is a sin. This is not a sin. Is this sin committed consciously or accidentally? It's not easy. Okay.
Thank you, sir. Can we take one more? One more? Okay.
I was expecting a pastor to ask question. I was expecting either you or Amagada to do this.
Okay, thank you so much, sir. At the beginning, you told us, or made it a difference, or tried to explain the difference between the man and the animal, even the apes and all that. And you said the man has one of the uniqueness, or about the man, is the soul. And from your explanation,
sorry, the spiritual soul.
The spiritual soul, yes.
Qualify it.
Okay. Now, I have been told or read that the man is made up of the body, the soul, and the spirit.
Okay.
So the aspect of the soul, can I conclude that the soul in a man is a seat of emotions and reasoning, which makes it the unique, or explains the uniqueness from the animal? Can I conclude that?
Okay, let me tell you my own personal understanding of this matter. First, you said three, not so? Yes. In the whole universe, only human being has matter, that's the body made of matter, and the spirit, that's the spiritual soul, combined to make a human being. Angels are 100% spirit. God, 100% spirit. Others are almost 100% matter. Human being is the only one who has a combination of both matter, that's making up the body, and the spiritual soul. You say spirit, soul, but I call it spiritual soul. You see how we come to that in? So it's a specialized soul. It's not the same soul, because if you look at the word, definition of the word soul in a good dictionary, you'll find that soul is like the living force. Even in animals, even in plants, they appear to have a living force. That is also their soul. But that of the human being is a spiritual soul, which you rightly said maybe is a spirit. But it's difficult to cut, read the Bible very well, where the soul is separated from the spirit. They are interwoven, so we call it a spiritual soul. Am I making sense? That is what makes the human being different and unique. And when the spiritual soul leaves the body, you say that person is dead. Now, that spiritual soul, what does it take along with it? It takes memory. That's where the memory is stored. So it's not completely the same as a computer. The brain also has memory. That is closer to the computer. You get the point? And the brain is here. The soul, where is its location? Is dispersed all over the body, more or less. You cannot say, this is where, if you dissect it, you will find the soul here. No. It's not like that. So, it's like, when it leaves the body, the human being dies. I've taken students at King's College when they were in, I think, from five in those days, to the mortuary, and they could not believe what they saw. This is their first time of ever going to the mortuary at age 17 or thereabout. Human beings lying there with eyes, ears, everything, legs, and all lying there flat. It was a traumatic experience for some of them. They had never seen it before. Stacked up like that, mortuary. Take your children to a mortuary. They come back sensible. You get the point? So what is missing? The only thing missing is the soul. They have legs, they have ears, they have legs, everything, but no soul. I was not teaching religion at that time. I was teaching biology. But it struck them that this human being looks like me and you, but unable to step out. I said, what is missing? The soul is no longer there. So let me just say, I agree with you to some extent, but as I said, I keep saying the spiritual soul is what distinguishes the human being from all others. And as I told you before, 2,500 years before Christ, Socrates, by use of reason alone, had postulated that the human being must have, that's what reason comes in, must have something that separates him from all the others. That is the spiritual soul that makes it possible for him, not just to, for example, I told about, if you look at a telescope, you'll see stars, you'll see other things. I don't think anybody will say the monkey does the same thing. No, they don't. I told somebody only recently, the elephant spends 15 hours a day, looking for and eating. That's all. 15 hours looking for food and eating food. That's the elephant. It's like a program. A program put there by its own DNA. That is what you are here for. Food and reproduction. Food and reproduction. The human being goes beyond that. We go beyond that. What are we doing here? We are thinking. We are exercising our thoughts. We are trying to develop ourselves mentally, I hope. We are listening to something that it maybe I can learn from this. We are always improving and improving. Look at the ordinary cell phone. You'll not believe it. I typed all of these on my cell phone, not on a laptop, on a cell phone. I use the cell phone to type all of this. So it's now possible. You get the point? So the human being is always developing, always crossing new frontiers. That is what the human being is for. The other animals are static. A goat will never eat meat. So is the elephant. It will never eat meat. It is programmed to eat grass. And we'll keep on eating grass. The other sorry thing I saw, I look at television, but I look at National Geographic. I have been doing this since I became a student librarian at Government College Wele when I was in Form 2. I was a student librarian, so I was very curious, and I kept on looking at books and reading. I saw something recently. Okay, you have seen National Geographic magazine. I used to look at it a lot. I saw something recently. I couldn't believe it. A group of chimpanzees, many of them, were all chatting, and a snake came in their midst and captured a baby chimpanzee and rolled around it and strangled it. Up to 30 of these chimpanzees, what were they doing? They were just making some sounds like that. They could not walk out. If all of them attacked the snake, they could save that baby chimpanzee. They could not walk it out because their minds are fixed. They're not able to reason together. If it happened among human beings and a baby is being taken by a snake, all of us here will hold the snake and pull it apart and save the baby. Monkeys could not do that. Something is missing. Am I making sense?
Yes, sir.
That's all.
We have two persons that would say one or two things. One is your student. One is your student, Dr. Shola Labinja. He's going to say something, that appreciation. Then after that, we'll give the microphone to another Asian mariner from the class of 1956, Mr. Festus Unuigbe, who's going to give another short vote of thanks. So I'll start with Dr. Shola.
Thank you very much indeed. When I got the invite to be here for this event, extremely excited, I would say. I didn't know what to expect, but I knew we were coming to celebrate a great man. And I want to start by thanking the members of the GCU for honoring one of your own. You are honoring the best. At a time when the society has changed and the values have changed almost beyond recognition, it is not usual to celebrate people at a time when they are not in power. People celebrate people who are in authority even when they are useless. They just want to be sycophantic and they say, this man, you can get something from him. So you say good things about him and then you rally around him and you say, oh, you are the best. But when you see people who celebrate people at this point in their lives and have this kind of elaborate celebration of people for their achievement, for positive contribution, not because they see them as money bags from whom they can financially benefit. I thank you for that. Those are the kind of values that are missing now. And that's part of why the country is retrogressing and not making progress. I thank you very much for this. I also feel very proud to listen to Mr. FX, as we call him in King's College. He will punish you for that at that time. But that's what you call him, FX. FX was coming in his immaculate white short sleeves, gentleman walking and around the corridor. And we always used to see this man as a quintessential gentleman. I feel very proud for this very visceral presentation. And I just said to myself, no wonder we learn from the best. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Shola. From the class of 1956, ancient man, Dr. Sunigbe.
It is sure. Ancient Mariner James Efekoro must have been a very, very wonderful teacher. He covered a variety of subjects, some of which have been topics of great arguments in the past. Evolution, Darwin's theory, Professor Hawkins. He covered so many fields, physics, astrophysics. He came to religion, soul, spirit, all in one day. He must have been a captivating teacher. And this is because at every point, he will give analogies. He will show you what and what happens. I was shocked when he said he took a class and was he took them to the mortuary to see dead body. That day I ran away from the school. Schools. I spent 3 months with him. I entered 56 September. By December, they changed the school year to become January. So I was class 1 in 56. I was class 1 57. We were the last of that class. And you can see the level of scholarship he has brought into this topic. The wide range of experience. So many things. Do you know the three degrees of freedom? I don't want to go into physics and so forth. But talk of freedom, the one that you must do, the one that you want to do, and the one that you ought to do, and left you to make a choice. I thank you, sir, for this wonderful discourse. I thank you for all the good you have done to all your students, like the doctor here present. And I thank you for doing our school proud. Hope to see you.
Thank you very much. We are going to...
Okay, gentlemen, sorry, ladies and gentlemen, especially the class of 1977, okay? Please take note. I'm anxious about one thing. You know our school, Government College Wele, has been in very dire straits for many years. And it is we the old boys, especially in the last 20 years, that have been propping up the school by carrying out major infrastructural repairs. Most of you have contributed one way or the other, and we are doing that. But I think the ultimate objective of coming together as old boys of a school is to also help that school to survive and to become better than the school we attended. I'm of the very strong view, and I've discussed it with my classmates, 1952 said, 16 out of 48 of us are alive, and we're all over the world. We brought them together via WhatsApp and Zoom. We are talking. And the main talk, unluckily, they asked me to do it, is how do we rescue the school? That's all. And I think your class is also thinking about the same thing. How do we rescue our old school? All government-owned schools have been in continuous state of dilapidation. I tell you this from personal experience, 9 years as an inspector of education. I've traveled around, not one, from King's College, unluckily, at the TBS just around the corner, to Dogbolu, to Maiduguri, all Federal Government College, Ikotekbene, 250 hectares. Have you seen such a school before? I was principal there. My daughter was my student, okay, and so on and so forth, okay? 250 hectares, all are dilapidated. We cannot allow this to continue forever. That's all. And I think that we should now begin to make up our minds on how to rescue these government colleges from the present proprietors. Not one of those proprietors. Take, for example, Delta State Government is trying to deceive itself by supervising 700 public secondary schools, Uwele being one of them. Do you expect that government, Delta State Government, with all the best intentions in the world, to do justice to this topic? It cannot do it. So we, the old boys, should now be talking about how do we extricate, I use that word, GCU from them. But my plea is that we cannot do it in segments. We must all come together and work as one GCU OBA. That is my prayer. I wish. What I can will help, because I've been in government service for 35 years, and I went into private education consultancy for 10 more years and helped to establish White Sands School in Lekki. It is a better school. It's a better school than all the public schools, and I mean it. So I think we can do the same thing for Uwele. Please, let us put our heads together and do that. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you very much, sir. Now we'll do a special one for him. Can we all rise to our feet? We'll take the school anthem, one, the two verses, and it's an honor to, Daddy, you need to sit down, you're our host. So we are singing the school anthem for you now.
God, you are so.
Thank you very much, Charles. Please, let's clap for him as he gets to his seat. Let's do that. Let's give him a warm round of applause. Thank you for honoring us. Gentlemen, we can sit down. Ladies, we can sit down. Please, thank you. It's almost dinner time. But we're getting ready for the fashion parade. If the models are ready, if the coordinator is ready, we want to show you what Government College has. I want to show you. Any fast tempo? Fast tempo now. Just fast tempo. Are we ready? These are merchandise. Are we ready, DJ? Just give us some nice music. In the next short possible times, these items will be available.
Brown, this is cool. Oh,
Give them a warm round of applause, ladies and gentlemen. Let's give them a warm round of applause. This merchandise will be ready in the nearest future. And we will tell you how to get them. We'll be ready in the very, very next few weeks. I will tell you how to get them. Gentlemen, it's now time for dinner and DJ, 1 minute. DJ, 1 minute. It's time for dinner, and the hotel management has told us that they take this COVID restrictions very, 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 very seriously. So what we want to do, we'll do it table by table. Once you allow a table to go, that table finishes and comes back. Then the next table will follow. And I think let's start with this table. We'll start with this table, yes. After this table, we'll go to the next one. DJ, please give us music. We go table by table.
We'll be right back.
giving to DJ. Ladies and gentlemen, we'd like to thank you. We now want to call one of promising younger old boys from the class of 2010, the Judah Lily, head of school, to give us a vote of thanks for this event. Can we give him a round of applause, please?
Ancient Mariners, dear presents, Mariners, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, guests, it's a privilege to be given this opportunity to propose a vote of thanks at this event. You would agree with me that you've enjoyed yourselves here in this ever busy city of Lagos, coming from our different destinations to gather as one family, as old boys as we are, and as invited guests. I wish to use this opportunity to thank all Ancient Mariners here present for making themselves available to this event. Also thanking all Mariners present, thanking our keynote speaker, Engineer Dr. Okezie Utomi, for his wonderful speech, which is indeed an eye-opener for us, again, added to the knowledge that we already have. Members of the platform of GCUF, every day we talk about politics. I get to read the messages there, get to follow up with the conversations. They are very engaging. So we see that the problems within our countries is not just alone for our leaders, that we have to participate as citizens that we are. I also wish to thank our ancient mariner who we are gathered here for today. Even though in his absence, he has left by James Efekodo. Every one of us who has been able to read the messages that he drops, and also being able to sit here listening to him speak and teach, not just speaking, but teaching. We've been able to gain one or two things from him. It is indeed an honor. I would also wish to definitely thank those who are behind this. Such an occasion like this is not something that is planned overnight. It must have been weeks of planning, months of planning, in the person of Mr. Cyril Ogude and his team. You can see how wonderful an event that they have put together with the aid and also commitment of all those boys here gathered. So thank you, thank you, thank you for gracing this occasion. Looking forward to seeing you shortly again when we gather together as old boys. Good evening, and you'll have a wonderful night's rest. Thank you.